comorbidities, minimally invasive muscle sparing surgical approach, less than 500 ml of intraoperative blood loss, use of tranexamic acid intraoperatively, and multimodal opioid sparing analgesia, which includes paracetamol, NSAIDs, and COX cyclooxygenase 2 inhibitors, prophylactic aspirin for venous thromboembolism, rehabilitation, and health education of patients by surgeons and primary care physicians. Challenges and issues of...
One minute. I'm going to interfere every bit that you're going to talk. Only then you will not... you write down. Whatever I'm saying, you write down the side itself so you all don't miss it. Okay. So you spoke about protocols. And when you spoke about protocols, you spoke about ASA 1 patient. It is not like that anymore. The thing has changed quite a bit. And nowadays, even ASA 3 patient can be taken up for daycare procedure, provided the procedure is small and provided the patient has understood the problems that they have to go through when they come for a daycare. If that is understood and explained, even a ASA 2 or 3 patients can be taken up, provided they are well under control. Whatever problems that they have, they could have hypertension with diabetes, with ischemic heart, where it can become ASA 2. But if they are under medication and they're well under control, it can be taken up as daycare. That is one thing. And then you spoke about how you have to explain to the patient. And a more important thing is explaining to the patient's relatives, because they are the people who are going to take care of them in the at home when you send them away to the home, to their own houses. So when that happens, you have to educate the relatives. So that is a very, very salient point that you have to mention when you're talking about this protocols. Okay. And can you mention that again? Can you tell me the protocols again? Is that all, or you have more?
Appropriate selection of patients with age less than 80 years and with no major comorbidities. Minimally invasive muscle sparing surgical approach. Less than 500 ml of intraoperative blood loss. And intraoperative use of tranexamic acids. Multimodal opioid sparing analgesia, which includes paracetamol, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and cyclooxygenase 2 inhibitors. And prophylactic aspirin for venous thromboembolism. Rehabilitation. And health education of patients by surgeon and primary care physicians.
Okay. Among the protocols, when you're talking like this, you say the protocols as far as the medical condition of the patient is concerned. Then the protocols where the surgery is concerned. What are the type of surgery that you would do? What are the medications that you will give to prevent further complication of that? So if you divide it like that, instead of saying haphazard, like, you know, what you said was, opioids sparing analgesic. Okay, it's very good. So you mentioned there saying it is preferable not to use opioids for daycare procedures due to the risk of respiratory depression in the postoperative period. You can't take it from the textbook and straight away say like that. Okay, so don't mention like that. So, and then you said about the use of tranexamic acid. Use of tranexamic acid is to minimize blood loss. One of the methods to minimize blood loss. You have to mention that, okay? And then you have to say about, you're saying less than 500 ml blood loss, which is very, very a valid point. But another important point that you have to mention is, in case the patient bleeds or in case the patient has some other problem in the intraoperative period, they will definitely be admitted and may not be continued as a daycare procedure. So you have to take a consent for that from the patient. You can't just leave them and say, no, it's okay, they're 100%. It's like laparoscopic surgery. Like in laparoscopic surgery, we say you'll go to open, isn't it? So like that, for in daycare procedure can also become a inpatient procedure if there is a complication. You have to mention that in the protocols itself. You have to get that in the consent itself. Okay? All right, continue. Go slow.
Challenges and issues in daycare arthroplasty. First one is surgical stress response. Increased inflammation not only sensitizes nociceptors with subsequent increased pain, but also results in immune, endothelial, and other organ dysfunction, which leads to fatigability, sleep disturbances, and increased risk for postoperative cognitive dysfunction. And second one is pain and analgesia. Moderate to severe pain occurs in 30-40% of patients after 2 weeks of surgery, with well-documented transition to persistent pain after daycare arthroplasty and overall increased analgesic consumption 1 year after surgery. Pain has direct negative impact on physical activity, sleep, cognitive function, and results in increased use of analgesics. And third one, functional status will decline immediately after surgery with gradual improvement over time until 1 year after surgery. Physiotherapy, a significant loss of quadriceps muscle function occurs by 2 to 3 days after arthroplasties, leading to reduced function and a need for rehabilitation. Possible cause for this are pain, edema, use of tourniquet, inflammation, and inhibitory reflexes. And another, next one is orthostatic intolerance. It occurs in patients after 24 hours of surgery with subsequent difficulties in early mobilization and increased risk for impaired recovery and increased morbidity. Cognitive dysfunction. It occurs a week after daycare arthroplasties and may be caused by predisposing factors such as pain, age, sleep problems, reduced preoperative cognitive capacity, inflammation, and opioid use. Delirium. Post-op delirium also one of the issues in daycare arthroplasty, but it is less frequent.
So these are, whatever you have spoken so far is the problem with arthroplasty. Okay, so it's nothing to do with anesthesia. So you don't have to elaborate on this so much. Definitely you will say about cognitive dysfunction, and definitely you will talk about orthostatic, where they're not able to stand, they're not able to walk and things like that. Those things you can talk, but it is not of great relevance to anesthesia. Okay, definitely it is mainly due to the orthopedic procedure itself. Quadriceps weakening, what happens after 1 year? Why are we so concerned about that? So don't waste your time on all this. Okay, don't have to, just enough if you just mentioned cognitive dysfunction, inability to walk, things like that. It's enough to say a few points. Okay.
That last one is sleep, found to be impaired severely during early post-op period. Some other studies also shown that increased daytime sleep and increased and decreased activity for at least first 9 days after daycare arthroplasty. The disrupted sleep pattern may exacerbate pain, which again impairs sleep and leading to vicious cycle of increased nociception.
Yeah, this is a very important point for us, because if the patient has a disturbed sleep pattern and the patient has got pain, so that is what we have to address. So how do we address that pain? Is the mainstay of a daycare procedure, pain management of arthroplasty for daycare procedure. So that is the mainstay of anesthesia. That is what you have to talk about now. Okay, pain management. Yeah. Your volume, your thing is breaking. Your voice is breaking.
That's it. I prepared for this question. Ma'am. Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yeah, now I can hear you.
Yes. That's all.
That's all. Absolutely, totally insufficient. Okay. So what else do you think you have to write? Like I told you in the beginning, these are the things that I want you to write. So what are the things you will write? What anesthesia will you give for this patient? What anesthesia can you give for this arthroplasty for daycare procedures?
Neuraxial anesthesia, neuraxial blockade. Man.
Totally wrong. Usually for daycare procedures, usually. Nowadays they give, but usually for daycare procedures, we don't attempt to give spinal anesthesia. Because though the effect of spinal wears off, the problems with spinal anesthesia, like a post-spinal headache or something else, can happen in the later stages also after spinal. So usually it is not, nowadays they give, because you have a very fine needle and things like that, they do give even for daycare procedures, but usually regional spinal anesthesia, central neuraxial anesthesia is not preferred. So what other anesthesia can you give? You can of course give general anesthesia for this patient. It can use, you don't have to use an endotracheal intubation and cuff tubes and IPPV, adala matter. You can use a supraglottic airway device and leave the patient on spontaneous ventilation. More important than that is to give a block. So what blocks can you give for knee arthroplasty? That you have to elaborate on that. You have to elaborate on the blocks that you can give for knee arthroplasty. What are the blocks and what are the problems because of the block? And what instruction will you give the patient following this? So if you want to do daycare procedure because you want to mobilize the patient fast, want the patient to walk home quickly. So that is what you're trying to do. But you can't do that when you're doing certain things. So how will you warn the patient? How will you warn the patient's relatives? What are the blocks that you can give in and around for knee arthroplasty? Tell me.
Adductor canal block. Adductor canal block.
Okay, you can give. How do you know how to give it? Can you describe adductor canal block? Can you attempt to
block? Femoral and sciatic block. Femoral and sciatic block.
Sciatic, you want to give sciatic block? What's it? You're doing a knee arthroplasty, right? So what are the nerves? That's why I said in the beginning, you have to draw the knee joint. You have to draw the nerves that supply the knee joint. You have to highlight the blocks that you will give for this patient. You have to write about the problems of daycare. You never gave any instructions to the patient. When you want to give anesthesia to this patient, have you seen the patient in the preoperative period? What investigations did you ask for this patient? Did you ask for the whole array of investigations, or did you have the minimal investigations done? How old was this patient? So suppose you take a patient. Now I'll give you an example. Okay, I'll give you an example. Say he's a 45-year-old. He's an athlete. And he's had a ligament tear, anterior ligament tear. So he's coming for an arthroscopy. Okay, he's coming for an arthroscopy. And he's posted as a daycare procedure. So how will you go about anesthetizing this patient? What anesthesia you will give and how will you anesthetize this patient? What are the procedures? You never even said the problems of daycare. You didn't even talk about how to prevent nausea, vomiting in post-operative period. And you said non-opioid analgesia, but you didn't mention what analgesia you will give, how much you will give, oral, and how you will give it. You must say everything. That should be more specific. You have read it. I'm sure you have read it from some journal or something, which has not given you any kind of proper dosing of the drugs and things like that. That is not the way to read. I specifically tell all the postgraduates, whatever you're reading, read it from a textbook first. Okay, any textbook. Take Miller or Morgan or any of the good textbooks. Read it first. Then you read the notes or whatever somebody gives you, read it after that. So without reading a text and without understanding, there is no point having a class like this. Okay, so it's totally inadequate. Whatever you said is totally inadequate. I have to say it straight on the face because I really don't mind, because this is something for you all to improve further, right? So whatever I have said now, please note it down. Write a nice theory paper. For how much marks is this? 10 marks, sir?
5 marks.
How much marks are you giving for each question?
10 marks, madam.
10 marks, yeah, 10 marks. So out of this, for you, suppose you are the examiner and I have written this, okay? How much will you give for this answer? You judge yourself, okay? You're a postgraduate. You're not a LKG student. You're a postgraduate. So you judge yourself and see how much will you give for this. Anything is okay. Tell me.
3 months.
That's okay. Okay, don't worry. All right. Okay, don't worry. So next time you write this today itself, after some time, after this class is over, you write it down again and then see how much you would have improved, taking all the clues that I have sent to you so far. Okay. Take it from a book. Actually, there is one site where typically it is given. Daycare procedure for arthroplasty, I don't know where I read it from, but everything about it is there. Okay, so look it up and write it nicely. For when you want to write it for 10 marks, you must write for 15 marks, then only you will get at least 8 marks. Okay, all right, okay, we'll go to the next one. All right, don't worry, if you don't done it yet, don't worry at all. Just because this topic has been given to you earlier. That's what I said. Here afterwards, what you'll do is you send it to me the previous 2 days prior so that I'll go through it. If you're not okay, I will send it, each of you, I'll send it to Kamakshi, and then you'll correct it and come into the class it'll be of use to the others, okay, and to you. Okay, good. Okay, we'll go to the next one. Don't worry, no problem. Yeah.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Somebody wants to say something.
Tarun Kumar.
Anybody else, any other teacher wants to comment on this? You can go ahead and say something.
Selvamani madam is with us.
Kamakshi, is somebody else there?
Selvamani is there, and Dr. Sushil Krishnan is faculty from NRCH. Professor Selvamani.
Yeah, if they want to say something, they can definitely pitch in.
Selvamani madam, we want to hear your comments, madam. Sushil boss? Dr. Sushil Krishnan? We'd like to have comments from you. Dr. Sushil? Okay, madam. Shall we move on to the next speaker, madam? Dr. Arun?
All right, we'll go on to the next topic. What's the next topic, please?
Good evening, madam.
Yeah, good evening.
Organ transplanted patient coming for incidental surgery.
Super. Yeah, come on. I like it very much. Good. Talk about it. Good.
Start up, madam.
Today is going to be a very unconventional method of teaching. So I'm going to say what is expected of you, and then we'll see how much of what I expected that you have done. Okay, so first I would like to say what organ transplant that the patient has had. What are the common organ transplants that the patients go through and what they come for? Okay, it can be renal transplant, it can be hepatic transplant, it can be cardiac transplant, lung transplant, pancreas transplant. That's all. So far, only that much. We don't have a brain transplant or face transplant and other things now, as of now, but it is surely going to come. Okay, so it could be any of those. Second, you could say, what are the drugs that the patient is on? What are the immunosuppressive drugs that the patient is on, and how these immunosuppressant drugs will affect the course of anesthesia, and what drug interactions that this can have. Okay, following that, you will say what precautions you will take to prevent rejection of the transplanted organ due to the anesthesia and surgery, of the incidental surgery that you're having. So what precautions you will take, and what technique of anesthesia you will choose for a particular patient to prevent such a complication, and how you will absolutely prepare the patient, preoperative evaluation, preparation, and management of the patient. Okay, so this is how it has to go. Particularly cardiac, there are certain problems. Lung, there are certain problems. So that should be highlighted. Okay, so this is the way you have to go about it. So let's see how you do it. All right, tell me.
The number of solid organ transplants has increased in the recent days because of the increase in the surgical techniques, as well as the presence of effective immunosuppressive drugs. So the common transplants are cardiac transplant.
And also, please mention, because of the improvement in the anesthetic techniques. You are an anesthetist, right? Yeah, so don't say about the surgery and the surgical techniques and the equipments that they use and things like that. You say, see, suppose you're giving open drop ether, okay? Like you have been when you started off with anesthesia so many years ago with WTG Morton, open drop ether. Can you do open head surgery now?
No.
You can't.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so you first mentioned about anesthesia, the importance of anesthesia and how the techniques of anesthesia and the drugs and everything have improved, and that is why you are having so many transplants, right? So that's the main thing. Okay, be proud of your profession first.
Sure.
Yeah,
so the number of solid organ transplant patients coming for elective surgeries has increased because of the surgical techniques improvements, effectiveness of the immunosuppressive therapies, and also because of the improved anesthetic techniques. So the commonly encountered surgeries in these patients are a laparotomy for a small bowel obstruction, hip arthroplasty, because most of the patients will be on steroids. So chances of avascular necrosis, fracture femur, and all those things are very common. And lymph node biopsy and excision, because the chances of lymphoproliferative diseases are very common post immunosuppressive therapies. And native nephrectomy in the case of kidney transplant recipients. Bronchoscopy procedures are very common, especially in a lung transplant patients. And biliary tract interventions like ERCP and other procedures are very common post liver transplants. Abscess drainage, because the chance of infection of these patients are very high post immunosuppressive therapy. So the anesthesiologist should be should mandatorily know, have a knowledge about all these things, so that the perioperative period is associated with less problems. So there are certain considerations that has to be kept in the perioperative period. The points are the problems of the allograft denervation, the adverse effects of several immunosuppressive agents. The commonly used immunosuppressive agents are cyclosporine, tacrolimus, steroids, mycophenolate mofetil, and other drugs, and its interactions with the anesthetic drugs. And the risk of infection are very high, so the prophylaxis, antibiotic prophylaxis, has to be kept in mind in the perioperative period. And the potentiality for an organ rejection, the immunocompetence of these patients can be already it's on the downside, so it can be altered by the stress as well as because of the surgery, and if there is any acute illness that is going to further worsen the immune status of the patient. So the preoperative assessment of the transplant recipients are done by estimating the physical reserve. The
okay,
reserve
one minute, one minute. You mentioned one minute. You mentioned all about some of the immunosuppressants that are being used, is it? So, so you said, can you tell me what these immunosuppressants do to the blood, like producing anemia and all that, cardiovascular system, endocrine system, whether it develops. What does it, each of them do? Do you know that? What does steroid do?
They suppress the humoral immunity, that is B lymphocytes are being suppressed so that the foreign antigen doesn't get recognized by the host immune system, so that they don't fight with each other.
But what happens to the body? What happens? See, suppose you give steroids, definitely there is a chance that the patient can develop hypertension. The patient can develop diabetes. The patient can develop neurotoxicity. Okay. So if they have steroid, they can have that. What happens when they give azathioprine? When the patient is on
azathioprine, it involves with the DNA nucleotide immunomodulations. So that it's a purine analog, madam. It's a purine analog.
All right, very good. Okay, but what does it do to the blood? It produces anemia. It produces anemia, it produces thrombocytopenia, it does leukopenia, okay?
Bone marrow suppression, so all the lineages.
Yeah, and also can have anaphylaxis. Right? So you must know what each of these drugs does to the body and what kind of interaction it has. So that is what makes the difference, isn't it? So you know that these patients are on these drugs. So you're still taking these tablets, it's okay, let it take. You can't do that. You must know that these are the things that happens to the patient when the patient is on these drugs. If the patient is on cyclosporin, they can develop hypertension, diabetes, neurotoxicity, renal insufficiency. If they're on tacrolimus, again, they can develop hypertension, diabetes. So the commonest side effect of any most of these drugs are hypertension, cardiovascular hypertension, and diabetes, neurotoxicity, and nephrotoxicity, renal insufficiency. So when you do a now you talk about preoperative evaluation. Having spoken this, you say how each drug can produce these problems, then you go to the pre-op evaluation. So that is when it makes sense, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am. I didn't go into the details of these drugs. So then.
No, you must know. You must write about each of those drugs. Because these are the drugs, you can just say it in mention. You can just mention. You can say,
cyclosporine predominantly versus hypertension.
Exactly. Usually it's only these four drugs. It's steroids, azathioprine, cyclosporine, and tacrolimus. Of course, there are so many other drugs, we don't have to talk about all that also. There's something called MMF, some lot of other drugs. You don't have to talk about all that. Yeah, yeah. You don't have to talk about all that. But these four you will have to mention because of their effect on the body system, producing hypertension, diabetes, and all that. Okay, so because that makes a difference to us when the patient is coming for some other surgery. Okay, so now you go to the pre-op evaluation.
Pre-op, so so sometimes there will be a persistent abnormalities on the underlying or the pre-existing illness in spite of the transplant that has to be evaluated. The pre-op evaluation will focus on the graft function, signs of rejection has to be seen, presence of any underlying infection, and the function of other organs. So the presence of any degree of rejection to be ruled out and to be managed pre-operatively with increased immunosuppression. Otherwise, the mortality is very high if it's untreated before surgery. So the immunosuppressive patients are at risk of infection that may be a bacterial, viral, fungal, which has to be ruled out by laboratory radiological investigations as well as microbiological tests like cultures. And the typical signs of infection won't be there in these patients because already they are immunosuppressed. So that's typical signs of infection won't be there.
Exactly. Exactly. That is the, that's the main reason thing I wanted you all to say, all of you to understand that the signs of infection and rejection are often absent. Okay. And even if the patient has a mild symptom, which was not there earlier, and has a problem of tiredness, has a mild abdominal pain, has some rash somewhere, or some kind of bowel changes in bowel habits. If they had any of these things, the anesthetist must be completely alert and say that this could be a infection or rejection, and you won't take up an elective case immediately. You will definitely prepare the patient, make sure that they are not in that stage before you give anesthesia for that patient. It's very, very important because the signs of infection and rejection are absent. It's not typical. Okay, very good. Okay, next.
And so it's so mandatory that we give an antibiotic prophylaxis for these patients before the skin incision, 1 hour before the skin incision. And associated problems like diabetes, systemic hypertension, epilepsy, renal dysfunction, bone marrow suppression, lymphoproliferative disorders, and adrenal insufficiency are some of the common side effects of these immunosuppressive agents. Hepatobiliary and pancreatic disease and upper GI bleed is very common secondary to the peptic ulcer as well as the chronic use of steroids. So it's mandatory that you give stress ulcer prophylaxis before surgery. They are high risk of developing a venous thromboembolism, and that prophylaxis has to be administered preoperatively. And a good coordination between the transplant team and the anesthesiologist and the surgeon is during the perioperative period is very important, especially if it's associated with a major surgery. So routine investigations that has to be done are CBC to rule out a bone marrow suppression, renal function test, a liver function test, coagulation profile including PT, APTT and an INR, chest X-ray, ECG and an echo. A complete cardiac testing has to be done to evaluate a cardiovascular disease as they are a very common cause of mortality and morbidity for any organ transplant patient, especially with a CKD patient or a previous heart transplant patient. Pre-medications would be a standard pre-medications as for us for a normal surgery for a non-organ transplant patients also, but beware of the benzodiazepines and all those things, considering if the hepatic and the liver function, hepatic and kidney functions are within normal limits. Supplemental steroids has to be given, and the dose of immunosuppressive drugs has to be continued and should not be altered. And on the day of surgery, it has to be continued and even continued in the post-operative period to reduce the chance of rejection.
Okay. Now you're talking about one minute. Now you're talking about general anesthesia. And you suddenly brought in midazolam, is it? So what you can say at this point, what you can say is this patient can be operated under regional anesthesia or general anesthesia, no issues, right? So if you're choosing regional anesthesia, you have to be hypotension, things like that must be much more because of the extensive denervation that the patient has got. Okay, but regional anesthesia as such, if just giving a block, so this is how you write in points. Say if you're giving regional anesthesia, it is good to give certain blocks and give a mild sedation and get out of it if it's a minor surgical procedure. And why do you prefer regional anesthesia is because it has its ability to preserve pulmonary functions better and also to reduce the stress response. Okay. And plus you can give an excellent post-operative pain relief with regional anesthesia in selected cases, depending on the case that you're coming for. Okay. And you must also say that the local anesthetics can get completely metabolized without any issue if it is not a liver transplanted patient. But even if it's a liver transplant, usually it is working well. So it's going to be completely metabolized and excreted. You're not going to have any issues. Then you take general anesthesia. In general anesthesia, you take the drugs. You take the iopentone, you take induction agent first. Then you take inhalation agent. Then you take muscle laxants. Then you take opioids. Then you take non-opioids. Then you take the midazolam and things like that. Suddenly, out of the blue, you don't talk about midazolam. Okay. All right.
I've written it in the back, madam. I mean, the following points will be coming in the...
Okay, all right. Okay.
So, the post-transplantation diabetes mellitus is a very common metabolic consequences of agents, immunosuppressive agents. So, tight glycemic control is very important preoperatively as well as intraoperatively. Oral cyclosporine should be administered 4 to 6 hours before surgery to maintain adequate therapeutic levels. There isn't such a thing that ideal anesthetic that can be used for these patients. General anesthesia can be done, a regional or a neuraxial blockade, depending upon the patient's condition, morbidity, as well as the hemodynamic status of the patient. All three can be preferred based on the patient's condition and morbidity. Monitoring, standard monitoring devices is applied. Invasive hemodynamic monitoring should be made, once again, based on the case basis, type of surgery, whether it's a major surgery, associated hemodynamic stability of the patient, and also the expertise of the anesthetist, as well as the type of surgery. So whatever is strict asepsis should be maintained in whatever procedure we do. Airway management, considering these are diabetic patients, airway difficulties like joint mobility by the glycolization of the connective tissues has to be kept in mind. So, and also lymphoproliferative growths are very common in these patients post-immunosuppression. So the chances of airway compromise, mediastinal mass, and all those things which can cause a life-threatening airway obstruction, especially after the induction during general anesthesia, has to be kept in mind. And gingival hyperplasia following cyclosporine use is very common. So bleeding chances, aspiration, laryngospasm, and all those things has to be kept in mind in these cases. And aspiration chances are very high because of the...
No saying all those things. You can't say all those things. That's not what you have to say, right? All those things are being, and that kind of a sentence should be taken off.
Fine. So there are chances of high aspiration. I mean, aspiration risk are very high because of the delayed gastric emptying, as well as because of the chronic diabetic patients. Oral intubation is preferred compared to a nasal because of the potential disruption of the nasal flora, especially considering these are immunocompromised patients. Intubation and laryngoscopy response is usually blunted, especially in a cardiac transplant recipients because of the denervation. An early post-op extubation is preferred to prevent nosocomial as well as ventilator-associated pneumonia. Coming to the general anesthesia, all inhalation and IV anesthetics can be used successfully in all transplant recipients. Once again, it is based on the type of surgery, hemodynamics of the patient, the cardiorespiratory reserve of the patient, as well as the pharmacokinetic properties of the drug. Dose of sedations like benzodiazepine has to be adjusted in hepatic and renal insufficiency patients. Inhalation, all inhalation agents has been used successfully. Halothane nowadays are not that used frequently, can cause hepatotoxicity, and it's wise to avoid it. Prolonged use of nitrous oxide is avoided because of the potential bone marrow suppression, as these are risky candidates following post-immunosuppression. Opioids, fentanyl is quite suitable for a short procedures, and sufentanyl can be used in prolonged surgery conditions. Sufentanyl can be used.
What does cyclosporine do? Cyclosporine potentiates the effect of barbiturates, fentanyl, and muscle laxants, particularly pecuronium and even atracurium when the patient is on long-term cyclosporine. So when the patient is on cyclosporine, the dosage may be lesser. Okay, when you might have to use a smaller dose of a non-depotizing muscle laxant. Okay, recovery time may be prolonged. This you have to keep in mind. What happens if the azathioprine? Azathioprine can antagonize the competitive neuromuscular blocking agents, because it has a phosphodiesterase inhibiting properties. So if the patient is on azathioprine for a long time, you might require a larger doses of the non-depolarizing muscle laxant, and it can also prolong the effect of succinylcholine. So these are all the things that you have to keep in mind when you talk about general anesthesia. What drug? That is why I asked about the interaction of immunosuppressants along with the muscle laxants in the beginning itself. And of course, choline is contraindicated in patients who have renal impairment or hyperkalemia. Okay, so that is something you have to keep in mind. All right. Okay. Very good. Next.
When coming to the neuromuscular blocking agents, shorter acting relaxants like mivaquirium is preferred. Intermediately acting, independent of kidney and liver functions, like acesatraquirium and atraquirium can be used. Vecuronium, rocuronium, and pancuronium are prolonged in terms of hepatic and renal insufficiency, and is better avoided in these cases. As you said, madam, immunosuppressive agents like azathioprine and cyclosporine prolongs the action of neuromuscular blocking drugs.
No, cyclosporine potentiates.
Regarding the cholinesterase inhibitor drugs, there is neostigmine and all those things are eliminated through kidney. So, cautiously used in the case of renal failure patients. And life-threatening bradycardia following neostigmine use in heart transplant patients have been documented. So, cautious use of these drugs has to be kept in mind. Regarding the neuraxial anesthesia, it's based on the individual basis. Considering the benefits as well as the risk of the techniques based on the bleeding complications and hemodynamics of the patient, the regional anesthesia, neuraxial blockade can be undertaken. Cautious correction of the hypovolemia before either an epidural or a spinal has to be done, which might attenuate the profound fall in BP during intraoperative period. There are increased chances of regarding the post-operative management, the success.
Okay. After this, are you going to tell me about specific organs?
Yes, madam. Following this, each and everything.
Okay. All right. Okay.
So, post-operative management, the successful outcome depends upon the optimum post-operative care. The patients are usually shifted to an ICU or post-anesthesia care unit, PACU. Appropriate analgesia is more important, and opioids are the mainstay of analgesia in the early post-operative period. Parenteral paracetamol is effective analgesic and may be used to spare the use of narcotics. NSAIDs or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents are avoided, considering nephrotoxicity and the GI bleed in these patients. And the immunosuppressive therapy has to be continued in the periop period also. And increased attenuation towards the preload status and the renal function and the preservation of the graft function has to be kept in mind even in the post-operative period. And moving on to the specific anesthetic considerations, I'll individually talk about all the transplants.
Just tell me the points.
Okay. First is the heart transplant recipients. These patients, they are completely denervated, so they lack the neurohormonal regulating mechanisms. So the sensory and there won't be any sympathetic and parasympathetic innervation. So the resting heart rate of these patients would be around 90 to 110 beats per minute, secondary to the loss of the vagal tone. And the resting ECG of these patients shows two P waves, one from the recipient SA node and other from the donor SA node. Certain patients might have a pacemaker in place. So a proper function of these pacemaker has to be confirmed and interrogation has to be done preoperatively. Invasive monitoring in the intraoperative period, either an invasive monitoring or an intraop trans esophageal echocardiogram may be considered, which might be used for intraoperative purpose. And predominantly, general anesthesia would be better for these cardiac transplant patients, as the chances of hypotension in a regional or a neuraxial blockade, the chances are very high. The general anesthesia would be a preferred technique for these patients, considering that we can manage the hemodynamics of the patient in the intraoperative period. So this is
a very important thing that you not mentioned here is the cardiac output is dependent on the venous return. okay,
preload,
and the circulating catecholamines, yes, on the preload. So you have to be very, very wary, and you have to avoid giving beta blockers for this patient. If the patients develop hypertension or anything, it is preferable not to give beta blockers. You have to keep that in mind. Hypovolemia, like you said, the preload is poorly tolerated by this patient, and it should be corrected properly itself. Okay. And what these patients come for is endomyocardial biopsy, just to make sure that the patient is not having any rejection and things like that. So you must know the levels of the tacrolimus that the patient is on when the patient comes for this. And then you said about the automaticity of the heart, and then spoke about the pacemaker, which is very good. So suppose this patient has not got a pacemaker, and there is some kind of a cardiac arrest and other things which is happening, what drugs can we give? Directly acting drugs. You can only give directly acting drugs. You can, like?
I mean, following a cardiac arrest, madam?
Yeah, if there is an arrest, if there is a problem, you can't give, suppose there is bradycardia. The patient is just going to collapse. It's not picking up, right?
Atropine doesn't have any effects.
Yeah, so what can you give?
Adrenaline would be the first, epinephrine would be the first choice.
Epinephrine, isoprenaline, dopamine. These are directly acting drugs. Okay. Epinephrine can be given because it is indirect and direct, so it's not a contraindication. But other things will not act. Anything that has to go through the sympathetic system will not act. That's what you have to keep in mind for a cardiac transplant patient. Okay. Yes or no?
Yeah, yes, madam. Yes.
Okay, okay. All right. Okay.
Moving on to the lung transplant recipients. Lung transplant recipients, once again, the denervation, these patients have a lack of cough reflex below the tracheal anastomosis level. So these patients would be unable to clear the secretions. So they are prone for retention as well as retention of the secretion, silent aspiration, and chances of pneumonia are very high in these patients. So in the case of general anesthesia, it is very hazardous to hazardous in presence of a chest infection, and the chances of severe bronchoconstriction and spasm and all those things are very common in the intraoperative and also the post-extubation period. So regional anesthesia would be a preferred one whenever possible in these patients. And a pre-op chest x-ray and spirometry has to be done prior to the elective surgery to exclude the chronic rejection as well as the presence of any underlying infection. So if any allograft rejection or infection is suspected, the elective surgery has to be postponed. And usually these patients have a poor lymphatic drainage post-transplant, so the chances of interstitial fluid accumulation is very high. So they have to be treated with the diuretics and limited crystalloid infusion to prevent volume overload status. And invasive hemodynamic monitoring is required in a case of a dual heart and lung transplant patients, because there will be a narrow line between the pulmonary edema occurrence as well as the maintaining cardiac output with judicious use of IV fluids. This is regarding lung transplant recipient. That's it.
The main thing that your thing is, what happens is there is something called a bronchiolitis obliterans, okay, which is a progressive narrowing of the smaller airways, which happen in more than 50% of the patients in about 2 to 3 years, up to 5 years, right? So y'all are the people who are going to face all this later in life, because this is how these patients are going to come, so especially after COVID and other things. There are so many people going through lung transplant, cardiac transplant, and things like that. We have gone through this, and we are not looking at so many patients who've got a transplanted organ. Okay, solid organ transplant patients coming to us for anesthesia or surgery is much lesser, right? Whereas when you all come up as consultants and other things, when you all are going into practice, this is how the patients are going to be. You are going to have a lot of patients coming with transplanted organs. It can be kidney, it can be a lung will come, a lot of lung problems will come. So you must realize that they have something called, what is called a bronchiolitis obliterans, okay, progressive narrowing of the smaller airways, and whatever you do, it is deteriorating of the function of the lung. So it's opportunistic infections will come in very, very common, and these patients will go in for a renal dysfunction very quickly. So you have to be very careful. Again, whether it's a cardiac transplant or a lung transplant or whatever, at the end of anesthesia and surgery, they will go for a multi-organ failure, especially a renal failure. So that's what happens most of the times. Okay. So keep that in mind. Okay. Very good. You've done very good. Okay. Cardiac lung.
Next is kidney transplant recipient.
Kidney. Okay.
So these patients have high chances of cardiovascular disease, especially with a elderly diabetic and being on dialysis for a prolonged period. Still, the GFR and the effective plasma flow can be significantly lower than in healthy because of the we have to be very cautious about the use of drugs that can be excreted via kidney, which might be prolonged. Persistent acidemia, proteinuria, and hypertension post transplant of these patients, we have to suspect a chronic graft rejection. Maintaining in the intraoperative period, it's wise to obtain maintain adequate renal perfusion pressure to prevent graft failure, and no diuretics has to be used in these patients without assessing the volume status of these patients, and ensure restoration and maintenance of intravascular volume in order to obtain a good graft function. Nephrotoxic drugs to be avoided, like NSAIDs, to be avoided in these patients, and it's very prudent to use certain drugs which doesn't rely on the kidney excretion.
Okay, one important point that you have to say here is the patient, if it's an early post transplant, the patient can have a functional AV fistula because the patient's kidney is not taken over yet. The recipient, the transplanted kidney is not taken over yet, and the functional AV fistula may be there. So it should be preserved to tide over if the patient has an early post transplant graft dysfunction. Okay, so you have to keep that in mind. That's all. You're doing very well. And of course, just like how we said, in the heart and the lung, you have to be careful about the kidney. In the kidney disease, you have to be careful about the cardiovascular system. Invariably, they'll have a coronary artery disease, but then renal transplant patients. So they will go for a cardiac failure in the postoperative period. You might have to, you might take a lot of precaution and do the kidney very well. You make sure, and then finally they develop a coronary artery disease and they'll die of cardiac failure. Okay, so that you have to keep in mind. Okay, carry on.
Regarding the liver transplant recipients, usually the liver synthetic functions get normalized in the early period, indicating the good liver graft function. The immediate reversal of hyperdynamic circulation as well as the cardiac performance improves in after a month of transplantation. The hypoxemia that is being caused by the ventilation perfusion mismatch is getting reversed in probably 1 or 2 months of post-transplant. The hepatorenal syndrome gradually diminishes and the renal function improves over a period of time, and the creatinine becomes normal. Kidneys are still in the danger of injury in spite of the reversal of hepatorenal syndrome due to the immunosuppressive side effects of the drugs affecting the kidney. The hepatic artery thrombosis, which is a very severe complication of liver transplantation, is commonly associated with massive blood transfusion, leading on to hemoconcentration. So transfusion of a lot of blood products in case if it's a major surgery in these patients has to be avoided to some extent. So these patients should have a minimal blood viscosity during the periop period. Regional techniques can be used if the coagulation profile as well as the platelets count of these patients are normal. So both general anesthesia and regional anesthesia can be used in these patients.
Another one important point that you have to say here is, if the patient had been sick in the pre-transplant period, who's had a hepatopulmonary or a portopulmonary hypertension, if the patient has had that, they can have residual pulmonary problems. So you have to be careful about that in the intraoperative and postoperative period of a hepatic transplanted patient. Otherwise, they are all fine. Okay. Anything else you want to add? I think we have been, though this question is only for 10 marks, we are just discussing everything, and so you can't write in points. You can't write as full sentences. You have to just write in points and try to finish the answer within that stipulated time. If you take so much time for one answer, then you will have no time for other answers. So this is what you need to practice. As anesthetists, like I said in the previous class itself, as anesthetists, we don't have this habit of writing anything. As it is, even in the anesthesia chart, it is either you put dots or you put a column or something like that and you're out of it. And pre-op anesthesia notes, it's all printed and you say plus, minus, and you tick and you do this and you come out. You don't write. So you get this habit of writing. So Kamakshi has made you all to do this because you'll get to a habit of writing. But time it and write. I'm discussing it as a longer thing because you need to know. That is why I'm discussing it. Okay, so this is the headline that under which you will write. I think you did very well. Excellent. You did very well. Anything else you have?
Last is an interesting
conclusion. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Tell me.
There are basically three types: isolated, a combined liver and intestine, or as part of a multivisceral. The main problem is graft rejection, which might manifest in the form of diarrhea, loss of weight and electrolyte, as well as acid-base imbalance. And chances of infection are very high, as the mucosal barrier gets disrupted and the bacteria gets translocated and causes severe septicemia, septic shock, and following acute kidney injury. Usually, these patients have a very difficult venous access because predominantly they'll be on a chronic total parenteral nutrition. So the venous access will be very difficult in these patients. That has to be kept in mind. And once again, in the intraoperative period, adequate fluid administration is very important to maintain the sphenic perfusion in these patients to prevent the graft rejection of the intestine. So that's it.
Okay, very good. Okay, most of it you covered. So I think you did a good job. The thing is, make sure about the timing and write it in points. Right? Okay, I think I purposely discussed because you all need to understand the whole concept. That's why I discussed it this long. Okay, all right. Okay.
Thank you.
The next topic.
Next up, Pavita from Chidambaram.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yeah, Pavitra, what are you going to talk on?
My topic is anesthetic management of children with a pediatric age group with congenital heart disease for non-cardiac surgery.
Okay.
Congenital cardiac abnormalities occur in 4 to 9 per 1,000 live births. 80% of these lesions are represented by atrial septal defect, ventral VSD, TOF, coarctation of aorta, patent ductus arteriosus, transposition of great artery. Also, along with this, some children have extra cardiac anomalies like tracheoesophageal fistula, anorectal anomalies, cleft lip, cleft palate, which may require surgery within first year of life.
When that is what we are concerned about. No? That is what we are going to talk about. They're coming for non-cardiac surgery, isn't it? The congenital heart disease, when they come for non-cardiac surgery, that's what we talk about every time we talk about a cleft lip or a palate or a hydrocephalus or a meningomyelocele or anything that we talk about in pediatric anesthesia. We always say rule out a congenital heart disease, isn't it? So these are the normal surgical conditions that the patient will come for in addition to having a congenital heart disease. So the commonest congenital heart disease they come for, what you said earlier, what are the congenital commonest ones? ASD, VSD, PDA?
ASD, VSD, TOF, coarctation of aorta, patent ductus arteriosus, transposition of great artery.
Okay, all right.
Presentation for incidental surgery. Before lesion is diagnosed, patient may undergo for unexpected complication during anesthesia, like cyanosis, arrhythmias, or ventricular dysfunction. The intervention for this is resuscitation and termination of surgery as soon as possible.
Why are you going straight away into that straight away into surgery, Pavitra? Why are you not talking about the physiology of a congenital heart disease when you talk about?
I have written afterwards, ma'am.
Afterwards, why are you talking about it now? Why should you talk about anesthesia and surgery now? There's no need to repeat that. You talk about in order. You talk about the each of the congenital heart disease, what it basically consists of, and what surgeries they come for, what they depend on, what are the congenital heart disease they depend on the preload, what are the things they depend on the afterload, what is the thing which they depend on the heart rate, so like that you go.
Okay.
Don't talk about what happens. Don't talk theory. I mean, like, don't talk from the notes.
Okay.
Understand the topic and talk about it.
Classification of congenital heart disease. Left to right shunts ASD, VSD, and patent ductus arteriosus. Right to left shunts or tetralogy of Fallot. Obstructive lesions are like aortic and pulmonary valvular stenosis and coarctation of aorta. Miscellaneous lesions like hypoplastic defects, mitral valve prolapse, and coronary arterial anomalies are present. Another classification based on hemodynamics of the lesion or acyanotic heart disease, left to right shunt, or ASD, VSD, PDA, and left heart obstruction like fiatation of aorta, aortic stenosis, and mitral stenosis. Cyanotic heart diseases, decreased pulmonary blood flow, conditions like tetralogy of Fallot, pulmonary stenosis, Epstein's anomaly, and increased pulmonary blood flow in conditions like transposition of great arteries, double outlet right ventricle, total anomalous pulmonary vein connection, truncus arteriosus. Single ventricle in hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Cardiac lesions have differently in children of different ages due to age-related hemodynamic conservations. Pathophysiology. Shunting. Shunting is a communication between the systemic and pulmonary circulation, and it's a common feature of congenital heart disease. Shunting is of two types, restrictive shunting and non-restrictive shunting. If the defect is small, shunt is primarily depends by the size of the defect, it comes under restrictive shunting. And if the defect is large, ASD or VSD, a pressure differential across the shunt is primarily depend on. Hello, ma'am?
Now I can hear.
Okay. If the defect is large, like ASD or VSD, a pressure differential across the shunt is primarily dependent on the pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance comes under non-restrictive shunt. Anesthetist's primary goal would be to preserve the balance of the existing shunts by manipulating these resistance. First, we have to know about factors affecting pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance. Increase in vascular resistance happens when there is hypoxia, hypercapnia, acidosis, sepsis, atelectasis, high airway pressure, vasoconstriction, light anesthesia, acetylcholine, histamine release, NSAIDs, prostaglandin, and norepinephrine. Decrease in pulmonary vascular resistance occurs in high FiO2, hypocarbia, alkalosis, fentanyl use, vasodilators, anemia, high altitude, prostaglandins, alpha antagonists, and beta stimulants. And factors affecting systemic vascular resistance. Increase in systemic vascular resistance in usage of alpha agonists, beta blockers, often lower extremities, increased intra-abdominal pressure and compression of aorta. Decrease in systemic vascular resistance occurs in inhaled anesthetics, vasodilators, alpha antagonists, beta stimulants, calcium channel blockers, nitroprusside, nitroglycerin, and prostaglandins, E1 and E2 usage. Increased pulmonary blood flow occurs when the shunt is from left to right is dominant. These lesions are well tolerated in pediatric patients undergoing for non-cardiac surgeries. This shunting is increased if pulmonary vascular resistance is reduced with high FiO2 or low PaCO2. And poor pulmonary blood flow is due to pulmonary valvular stenosis or severe pulmonary hypertension with the right to left shunt. This often presents as hypoxemia. Arterial saturation depends on the
We can't hear you.
Hello, ma'am.
We can't hear you. No, it's breaking. Your voice is breaking.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Okay, compare with the country.
Hello, ma'am.
Breaking again.
Ma'am, can you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah, we can hear you, but it's breaking. Just make sure that your thing is
okay. Carry on. Arterial saturation depends on the ratio of pulmonary to systemic blood flow. If children who are already cyanosed, an increase in right to left shunt is poorly tolerated, a primary concern is to maintain this ventricular performance and a ratio of pulmonary to systemic blood flow. In children with decreased pulmonary blood flow, should maintain by avoiding hypoxemia and any sudden increases in systemic oxygen demand like crying, struggling, and inadequate level of anesthesia. Pre-op checklist for pediatric patients undergoing for non-cardiac surgeries. Assessment and analysis of patient records for diagnosis, and has the congenital heart disease been corrected previously, or is it uncorrected or palliated? And consultation with pediatric cardiologist with following investigations like ECG, chest X-ray, oxygen saturation,
arterial blood. Namakshi, you can hear her?
Yes, madam, hello? I can hear. I can hear. Her voice is very clear.
I can't hear you at all.
Can you hear me, madam? Can you hear me, madam? Am I audible, madam? Pavitra, I'm able to hear you. Hello?
Hello, ma'am.
Now I can hear you.
Okay. Approach to a child with congenital heart disease. Current medications. Current medications, ask for current medications, and all medications, generally all medications should be continued. Anticoagulation management should be done after discussion with the surgical team and cardiologist. And to know about medications required in the past, and history of any allergies, and whether prophylactic antibiotics have been given in the past have to be inquired. An assessment and analysis of the patient records for the diagnosis. Has the congenital heart disease been corrected? Is it uncorrected or palliated? Consultation with pediatric cardiologist with following investigations like ECG, chest X-ray, oxygen saturation, arterial blood gas, echo, exercise testing, cardiac MRI, serum electrolytes, and blood sugar, hematocrit to be taken. To know about the pathophysiology and adequacy of the cardiac output, to know is there any severe polycythemia, to anticipate will pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance require manipulation to optimize systemic or pulmonary blood flow, to analyze what hemodynamic changes can be expected during stress of surgery and anesthesia, and is there any risk of worsening hypoxia. And to anticipate a need for any endocarditis prophylaxis, and to anticipate is there a risk of paradoxical embolization because of right to left shunt. Hello, ma'am.
Okay, and what is the endocarditis prophylaxis, which has been advised nowadays? Use of antibiotics.
Antibiotic prophylaxis nowadays are not recommended for congenital heart disease.
Yeah, only if they have a repaired congenital heart and has a prosthetic material or some device where there has been some kind of a catheter intervention and things like that within the during the first 6 months after placement. Only then you need to give. That is the latest. Latest for endocarditis prophylaxis is patient with prosthetic cardiac valves, patients who have had a prior infective endocarditis, and patients who have a palliated shunt in congenital heart disease. If patients have got a palliated shunt, like a Blalock toxic shunt or a Fonton shunt or something, one of those shunt and conduits, if it has been there, then you have to give. If it is unrepaired or a partially repaired palliative shunt which has been done, and they have a residual defect, Suppose a patient has got a congenital heart disease and they have a residual defect and have a prosthetic patch or something, then that can giving a problem as the endocarditis. Only these patients require endocarditis prophylaxis. Earlier days, anybody who had a congenital heart disease, anybody who had a valvular heart disease will go through this. Whereas now it's not like that. Okay, so there's been some change in the endocarditis prophylaxis. That can be asked like a theory question for you at any point of time. Just read up the latest guidelines on that. Okay, very good, Pavitra. Continue.
Okay. Yeah. Pre-op sedation. Children with congenital heart disease should be shifted to OT sedator to avoid the fear and stress associated with the procedure. Airway management. It can range from spontaneous respiration with sedation.
No. Just 1 minute. You're talking about sedation. Why don't you say what sedation? Why don't you say you will give midazolam, you will give 0.5 milligram per kg orally, or you will give 0.05 to, what is the dose? 0.2 milligram per kg IV. Or what are the drugs you will give? How you will give it, things like that you must say. Just don't say sedation. You say sedation, it has to be done in the OT, it has to be done under supervision. And these are the drugs that can be given, 1, 2, 3. Okay, you must talk like that. You must not keep on saying, I will prevent hypoxia, I will prevent, everybody has to prevent hypoxia, hypertension, whatever that you have to do. You have to say what you will do for it. Okay, all right. Sedation, if you say sedation, you will say midazolam. Or triclorophos, isn't it? Another drug which is commonly given is pediclorol, isn't it? Pediclorol syrup is given. Okay, all right. So you must write the dosage and you must say the route. Whenever you say sedation, you must say the drug, you must say the dosage, you must tell the route. Okay, and when you will give it. Okay, continue.
Okay. Airway management. It can range from spontaneous respiration with sedation to general anesthesia with a mask or laryngeal mask airway or ET tube care to maintain normocardia. Minimize the positive pressure ventilation on the pathophysiology of cardiac lesions. Anesthetic techniques. Patients with congenital heart disease, after careful assessment of the particular pathophysiology and required hemodynamic goals to be decided, inhalational induction with CO fluorine is most commonly used. Propofol may be used. Its usage is decreased nowadays because of its vasodilation. Ketamine is very useful as it maintains the systemic vascular resistance. Single shot caudal or nerve blocks can be used even with aspirin, but a major neuraxial block is best avoided. In left to right shunt, inhalational induction is faster in action, where intravenous induction is slower. In right to left shunt, intravenous induction is faster, while volatile induction is slower.
Why?
Systemic air embolism.
Why? Chuma, just like that, I'll ask you one question. Why?
Ma'am, in right to left shunt, there will be pulmonary condition. Pulmonary condition will be there.
Phallus tetralogy? In phallus, what happens?
Right to left shunt will be there, ma'am.
Okay, what will happen to the pulmonary circulation?
Pulmonary vascular resistance will be increased, ma'am. Decreased pulmonary vascular resistance.
What happens to the circulation? Is there pulmonary? Is there any pulmonary circulation at all? There is pulmonary stenosis. There is pulmonary oligemia. Pulmonary oligemia. There is not much, there is no circulation there, isn't it? So that's the main reason.
Okay.
Yeah, one of the components is pulmonary stenosis. So what happens? So can you do inhalation induction for this patient?
No, ma'am.
See, when you read, when you do this, please apply yourself and understand the pathophysiology of the effects that you're doing, okay? Just don't say right to left shunt, I will not give right to right. It's not like that. You understand what you're talking about. Okay. Okay, continue.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Systemic air emboli is constant threat in children with congenital heart disease because of dynamic nature of shunts during anesthesia and surgery. Adequate monitoring have to be done intraoperatively, ECG, pulse oximetry, non-invasive blood pressure monitoring.
Prevent this air embolism, whatever. First of all, you say de-airing of the intravenous line is extremely important. There should not be even a small drop of air in the IV line. Without saying that, how is it complete? How is your answer complete? Understand? You're talking about embolism. So what will you do to prevent that? So de-airing of the intravenous line is of utmost importance. If you don't write that, it is of no use. Okay.
Okay.
Continue. All of you do the same thing.
Adequate monitoring like ECG, pulse oximetry, non-invasive blood pressure monitoring, ETCO2 monitoring, temperature monitoring, precordial stethoscope, and invasive arterial blood pressure and CVP monitoring to be done. If implanted defibrillator is present, it should be converted to an asynchronous mode just before the surgery to avoid the electrocautery interference. Left to right anesthetic considerations in left to right shunt. Generally, hemodynamic consequences in left to right shunt are increased pulmonary blood flow with pulmonary congestion, volume overload, increased work for left ventricle to increase the stroke volume, and lower cardiac output will be there. Increased pulmonary blood flow reduces the pulmonary compliance, increases the work of breathing, leads to respiratory failure. If left uncorrected, right ventricular hypertrophy and elevated pulmonary artery pressure leads to Eisenmenger physiology, which leads to severe desaturation. Severe left to right shunt causes hyperperfusion of the vital organs. Hemodynamic goals are to be avoid increase in systemic vascular resistance and to avoid decrease in pulmonary vascular resistance. Hence, volatile anesthetics that decreases the systemic vascular resistance and positive pressure ventilation, which increases the pulmonary vascular resistance, are well tolerated. Disadvantages like anesthetic overdose, gross volume overload, loss of airway, as it aggravates the left to right shunt. Anesthetic considerations in atrial septal defect. Here, pre-medication can be done like a normal patient. Care taken to be avoid venous air embolism, as paradoxical arterial embolism may occur as the shunt is left to right at atrial level. Interventions like positive airway pressure and Valsalva maneuver increases right atrial pressure more than the left atrial pressure, which reverses the direction of the shunt flow. Disadvantages like atrial dysrhythmias and heart block may occur after ASD repair. Anesthetic implications in VSD. Pressure-related problems are...
One minute. We're not talking about ASD repair. We're talking about a patient who's got an ASD who's come for incidental surgery. Okay. So suppose this patient, a patient with ASD, known case of ASD, has not corrected. Okay. It's just there. The ASD is there. So you will assess in the preoperative period and see how much, whether the patient's got pulmonary hypertension or not or whatever, and then you will choose some kind of anesthesia. So you set the goals of anesthesia. Yes, you don't want to increase the shunt, you don't want to do a thing, you must make sure that the IV lines are de-aired completely. Suppose the patient has come for hernia. Okay, patient, child with ASD, 2-year-old child, male child, has come for a hernia repair. Yes. What anesthesia you will give for this patient? Don't keep on saying all kinds of things without telling what exactly you will do for the patient. What will you do for this patient? What will be your choice of anesthesia?
Ma'am, if ASD is already closed, neuraxial anesthesia, caudal block can be preferred, ma'am.
Okay. So you can caudal block without giving any anesthesia. You want to give a caudal block for the child, or you want to give something? You want to give sedation, or you want to give, you want to hold a mask with sevoflurane? Start general anesthesia. Okay, yeah, don't trauma.
Okay.
For pediatric cases alone, okay. Never say only the block without giving general anesthesia. It's not at all, okay. Though people are doing it, it's not very humane to do things like that, isn't it? Yeah, so yes. They always give at least make the child sleep and then give. Even for adults, actually, it's safer that way. But we can't do it all the time. So it is it's okay with adults. But children, you will definitely do this. Okay, all right. Continue.
Okay. Anesthetic implications in VSD. Pressure-related problems are most common with VSD more than ASD because of the defect lies between the high-pressure cardiac chambers. Pre-medication depends on the amount of ventricular dysfunction. In large VSDs, ventilation needs to be adjusted to maintain normocapnia and limit the FiO2 to prevent reduction of pulmonary vascular resistance and pulmonary blood flow. Avoid fluid overload. Induction also depends on ventricular dysfunction. Inhalational induction used if LV function is good. With poor LV function, opioid or ketamine induction is preferable.
Okay.
In patent ductus arteriosus. Ductus arteriosus is the vascular structure connecting main pulmonary artery with proximal descending aorta, commonly seen in premature babies. Anesthetic management, like it includes fluid restriction, can be done. Supplemental O2, corrective measures are fluid restriction, supplemental O2, indomethacin, prostaglandins. If the baby,
no, we are not talking about all that. Look here. 1 minute. See, you're going away from the topic. Our topic is congenital heart disease patient has come for a non-cardiac surgery. So why do you want to talk about all waste time on all that? We don't want to hear all that, isn't it? We know the patient has got a PVA. The patient has come for some other surgery. So the hemodynamics of PD, what happens when the PDA is there and what problems the patient can have. That's all. So based on that, what anesthesia you will give for that patient. So that is how we must talk. We don't have to talk about treatment of PDA and indomethacin and all that. That's not what we are talking about now. We're not talking about management of the congenital heart disease. Understand? Okay. Don't waste your time and all that. Okay. Yeah, continue. Next one.
In PDA, maintain saturation at not more than 85 to 90 to minimize the risk of retrolental fibroplasia.
Okay.
Right to
left.
That's
the point. Exactly. That is the point you have to mention. Right. Very good. Okay.
In right to left shunt, hemodynamic consequences in right to left shunt are decreased pulmonary blood flow, hypoxemia, left ventricular volume overload, left ventricular dysfunction, which results in deoxygenation blood. Results in the deoxygenated blood to enter into the systemic circulation, which further causes cyanosis. A child with chronic hypoxemia compensates by increased hematocrit. Increased hematocrit can cause renal and cerebral thromboembolic phenomenon, increased blood viscosity, increased incidence of coagulopathies. In right to left shunts, inhalational induction is very slow and physiological dead space is more. IV onset of drugs are more rapid in action. Hence, it is prudent to reduce the rate of IV injection of depressant drugs in these patients. Avoid systemic hypotension.
Like what? See, instead of going on beating around the bush like this, you just say, suppose it's a phallus. Okay, this is a case of a phallus. Obviously, hematocrit is high, you have cynosis, you have a thing. So they have thrombosis, they have sludging. So now they have a cerebral thrombus, the cerebral abscess. That's what they come for, isn't it? A patient with tetralogy of Fallot coming for cerebral abscess drainage. This is the question that they will ask you. So based on this, what will you give? How will you give anesthesia for this patient? Don't keep beating around the bush and saying so much of theory. It doesn't make sense. So how will you give anesthesia for this patient? Suppose it's a tetralogy of Fallot, cerebral abscess. How will you give anesthesia for?
Preoperatively, I have to ask for the history
Aims will be to?
History of previous and history of previous any palliative procedures have been done, have to ask, ma'am. Limit the pre-op fasting and dehydration and consider IV fluids overnight. Give light medication and oxygen supplementation. Avoid crying as it precipitates the dead spells.
Very
beta
good.
Blocker
Excellent.
Prophylaxis need to be continued on the day of surgery, ma'am.
Correct.
Intraoperatively monitor then, the adequacy of oxygenation and the pulmonary blood flow. Anesthetic agents that decreasing the systemic vascular resistance are not advised. In severe cyanosis, ketamine IM or IV is the induction of choice as it maintains the systemic vascular resistance. Inhalational induction is acceptable in less cyanosed negative, patients. Negative
ionotropism. Intravenous ketamine preferable.
Okay. Next. Negative ionotropism of halothane is useful in treatment of infundibular spasm. Ventilation may be with O2 or with O2 in air depending on the cyanosis, ma'am.
And how you maintain
summary,
you're giving ketamine. How are you maintaining anesthesia? Are you giving oxygen air? What else are you giving?
PEEP to be avoided, ma'am.
Okay. Are you you're intubating, is it? Are you intubating the child?
Yes, ma'am, I'm intubating.
What relaxant do you use? So suppose the question is congenital heart disease patient for non-cardiac surgery, right? This is a non-cardiac surgery, abscess.
Okay.
Right? So you will say the problems of the congenital heart disease, the fallos, whatever the patient has. The history you asked very well. You said everything correctly. Aims of anesthetic goals. You will say the anesthetic goals. Then you say technique of anesthesia, right? You will say I will give intravenous ketamine and I'll intubate with atracurium, and then I will ventilate. This is the ventilation I'll do. I will avoid using nitrous oxide, and small doses ventilation doses is acceptable. So things like that you have to mention. And hydration.
Okay.
You have to maintain good hydration, and then and because of the thing, you have to prevent ICT, increase in the ICT because of cerebral abscess. At the same time, you have to avoid PEEP because of other problems the patient can have. This is how you have to mention. Don't go away from the question. Don't just carry it away and keep talking all kinds of things. Then you will have no time for the actual answer. Okay. All right.
Okay.
Okay, Pavitra, okay. What else do you have?
Over, ma'am.
Okay.
I finished.
So this is, yeah, okay. So this is what I found about you. Have read everything. You have got most of the points, but the thing is you're going away from the actual presentation that you need to make. Okay. You're going completely off. Where are you? Where are you? I can't see you. You there?
Mom, I'm here, ma'am.
Okay, I can see myself also. Doesn't matter. Okay, all right. So something keeps going wrong with this. But you can hear me, no? All of you can hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
We are able to
hear you.
Okay. So that's what it is, Pavitra. Otherwise, you prepared quite well. But make sure that you don't go off the point and stick to back to the question. Okay? So that's all it is. All right.
Okay.
I think somebody has to. Can one of you who's been listening, can you summarize it? Can someone summarize it? Any other postgraduate can summarize it quickly? So that I will know how much you have listened, how much has gone in. Pavitra, you yourself summarize in 5 minutes what I told you. Make the corrections. And you summarize it.
First, we have to mention about the introduction and mention about the classification of the congenital heart diseases and acyanotic heart diseases, cyanotic heart diseases. And next we have to write about the pathophysiology, ma'am. The classification of shunts and explanation about the pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance and factors affecting pulmonary vascular resistance systemic vascular resistance have to be written, ma'am.
Okay. See, when you talk about anything in the cardiac, these are the few words that you have to bring in. Okay, you have to get in the preload, you have to get the afterload, you have to get the cardiac output, you have to get the heart rate, You have to get the systemic vascular resistance. You have to get the pulmonary vascular resistance. That's all. Based on this, if you understand, then you will talk about in every disease, this is what the changes are. And what you want is, when you give anesthesia, what are the things you have to, where you have to reduce the pulmonary vascular resistance, where you have to reduce the systemic vascular resistance. That is the pathophysiology and the circulation that you have to understand. If you understand that, you will have no issues about presenting anything, any case. Okay, so this is how it is. Okay, continue.
Preoperative assessment. In that we have to ask for the history of previous medications and previous any procedures done and any all investigations like ECG, chest X-ray, put echo, cardiac MRI, serum electrolytes and blood sugar and hematocrit. Next, preoperative sedations, in which we have to mention about the drugs and what drugs we are giving and dosage and the route of the drug. And airway management. And airway management, then airway management, how we are the choice of the how we are managing induction. With GA or induction. And anesthetic techniques, whether inhalational induction or IV induction, we have to mention about it and explain them. In right to left to right shunt, inhalational induction is faster, and right to left shunt, intravenous induction is faster. And intraoperative monitoring, what are the parameters we have to monitor? We have to mention them. And we have to explain separately, like left to right shunts, what are the hemodynamic consequences happening, and every anesthetic considerations in a single pathophysiology like ASD, VSD, and PDA have to mention, and right to left shunt hemodynamic consequences, and what are the anesthetic considerations we are mentioning, and the tetralogy of Fallot and other lesions have to be mentioned, ma'am, and conclusion, ma'am.
Yeah, very good. Everything you say in points. I think you got the crux of it. At the end of this, which is
okay.
Yeah, good. Okay, all right.
Okay.
What's the next?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Pavitra.
Thank you.
Now, Dr. Pavitra from NRCH New Delhi. She will talk about capnography. Dr. Pavitra from NRCH.
Good evening, ma'am.
Another Pavitra is coming.
Good evening, ma'am.
From Delhi.
Good evening, Pavitra.
Hello,
what's
ma'am,
your topic? Yeah.
Ma'am, my topic is on capnography, ma'am. Capnography, ma'am.
Okay, carry on.
Can I start, ma'am?
Yeah, you can start, please.
Ma'am, the topic capnography given is as general, ma'am. There is no specific, the precise questions like applications or something. So I want to discuss full capnography, ma'am.
Okay. See how best we can do it? In a concise way. Okay, let's see how you do it. No problem, carry on. Can't hear you.
Five physical methods, ma'am. Ma'am,
we are not able to hear you.
Yeah. It's breaking.
There are five physical methods by which capnography can be measured. First is infrared spectrography. Second is molecular correlation spectrography. Third is Raman spectrography. Fourth is mass spectrography. Fifth is photoacoustic spectrography. Ma'am, if you want me to explain all these things, I will explain, ma'am. No,
you will not explain all that, because that is not what is expected of you for a mark, which you have to talk about for about 10 or 15 marks. You don't have to explain about each of them.
Okay, ma'am. And one more is the colorimetric method, which is a litmus paper, which is used for detection of the correct placement of the ET tube.
Okay.
And in capnography, there are two types, sidestream capnography and mainstream capnography. side stream capnography is a diverting method. It uses a pump to aspirate gas from the sampling site through a sampling tube to the sensor that is located in the main unit. And it is used for both intubated and non-intubated patients. It is a most widely used method. The gas sampling tube is inserted in between the breathing circuit and the endotracheal tube. Only the manufacturer recommended tubing material and length must be used. There is a slight delay in the display of the CO2 waveform. And the main advantage of the side stream capnography is that it can be used in non-intubated patients also for instance sedation, and it can be used along with the oxygen face mask. The main drawback of this is the blocking of the tubing with the water vapor or secretions. The main stream capnography is a non-diverting method. The sensor is located directly in the gas stream. It is mainly used in the intubated patients. The sensor contains an infrared measurement device and a sensor with an electrical cord, and the graph is depicted in the monitor. The adapter containing infrared sensor is posed between the patient's breathing circuit and the ET tube, and the sensor emits infrared light to a photo detector on the other side of the adapter, and the CO2 waveform is measured. For intubated patients, the lighter weight adapter should be used. Otherwise, there will be a drag in the ET tube, and the chance of ET tube displacements are there. And the mainstream sensor, the main disadvantage is it should be heated above the body temperature to prevent water vapor condensation, and there are high risk of facial burns with the mainstream capnography. The types of capnography, volume capnography, the expired CO2 waveform is plotted against the expiratory flow rate. It allows the calculation of total CO2 production and the respiratory dead space. It is not widely used.
Instead of writing, so you think you have, so 1 minute, Pavitra, do you think you'll have time to write all this? When you're talking about capnography, what we expect to see when you talk about capnography is, first of all, what is capnography? What is it used for? What are the indications? What are the types of capnography? When you talk about types, of course, you said about the side stream and mainstream. You talk about the advantages and disadvantages. Then you talk about the principle of capnography. Then you say about the waveforms. What are the normal waveforms? What are the abnormal waveforms? And where are the conditions where the ETCO2 becomes low? What are the conditions where the ETCO2 becomes high? On a ventilated patient, if the ETCO2 becomes high, what are the complications? If the ETCO2 comes low, what are the problems? How will you rectify that? So that is what is expected of you, rather than wasting your time on so much of your other things. Okay, so talk on these terms. Yeah, all right.
Ma'am, the volume capnography is mainly used for intubated patients in the ICU to calculate the VQ mismatch, ma'am. Going to the time capnography, ma'am. Time capnography, okay. the CO2 concentration is displaced against the time. It is mostly commonly used in clinical practice. It is available for spontaneously breathing patients and the intubated patients. The time capnography consists of two segments, inspiratory segment and expiratory segment. In the inspiratory segment, it is phase zero. The inspiratory downstroke is there. It is the inhalation of the CO2 free gas. Patient inspires the fresh gas. And in the expiratory segment, it consists of phase one. Phase one is the initial stage of exhalation in which the gas is sampled in the anatomical dead space and the apparatus dead space, which is which consists of the dead space ventilation. And the phase two is the expiratory upstroke. It is a combination of dead space and the alveolar gas. And phase three is the alveolar plateau phase.
Have you drawn the diagram, and have you written the phases and the angle?
I have drawn the graph, ma'am.
Okay.
And I have sent already yesterday itself.
Okay.
Phase 3 consists of alveolar plateau phase. It is the exhalation of the alveolar glass. So it is in a steady state in the plateau phase. And it consists of two angles, alpha angle and a beta angle. alpha angle is the angle between the phase 2 and phase 3, which the normal alpha angle is 100 to 110 degrees. It is increased in the airway obstruction, bronchospasm, COPD condition. So the beta angle is the angle between the phase 3 and 0, and it increases during rebreathing, ma'am. The normal beta angle is 90 degrees, ma'am.
Okay, very good.
Okay. Ma'am, the applications of time capnography, ma'am. It is mainly used in the operating rooms. It is used for assessing the tracheal tube or tracheostomy patency and position. It used to assess the adequacy of ventilation, and it is used for procedural sedation, respiratory monitoring, ma'am. During percutaneous tracheostomy placement, and monitoring patients with the raised ICT, because it gives the value of the PACO2, ma'am, and in monitoring response to the treatment of bronchospasm, and it used in the estimation of cardiac output and assessment of efficacy of CPR and prediction of survivability, ma'am.
Tell me the use of capnography in CPR. Suppose you have a short notes on use of capnography in CPR. What will you write?
Ma'am, the use of capnography in CPR are first in assessing the ET tube placement if the patient is intubated. We can consider patient, if intubating the patient, placement of the ET tube can be confirmed with capnography, ma'am, tracheostomy.
No, need not be intubated at all. The patient need not be intubated at all. Even without intubation, you can still find out whether how do you do it?
Ma'am, the rise in the ETCO2 levels, ma'am. If the rise in the ETCO2 levels more than 10 mm Hg by the waveform capnography, after 20 minutes of the CPR, it is success in the CPR, ma'am. And even after 20 minutes of CPR, if the ETCO2 is not more than 10 mmHg, then the rested efforts can be terminated, ma'am. It's the one of the criteria, ma'am.
ETCO2 level of 20 millimeters of mercury or greater indicates that there is a adequate chest compression during CPR.
Return of spontaneous circulation.
ROC, yeah. And if there is a failure to achieve a level of at least 10 millimeters of mercury, like you said earlier, even after 20 minutes
CPR,
you have to make a decision to terminate the CPR.
Ma'am, okay. It is one of the criteria. So,
yes, that's one. So you have to keep that in mind. When they ask you a question like that, we expect you to say all these things. Okay. All right.
Okay,
continue.
Ma'am, it is used for the correction of the fluid responsiveness, and can be used in the seizures and postoperative care.
Okay.
And the limitations of the capnography, ma'am. The limitations are false positive CO2 detection in the esophageal intubations if the patient have ingested carbonated beverages, ma'am.
Okay, that's really for a very short time, is it? Okay, all right.
And in colorimetric method also, if the litmus paper is exposed to the acidic solution or the stomach content, it may give a false positive value.
Correct.
And mainstream, thank you, ma'am. And mainstream devices are kept near face, ma'am. There are the heated mainstream devices may cause facial burns.
Okay.
And the side stream devices may result in the time delay to exhibit the waveform, ma'am. And the sampling lines are more prone for obstruction due to secretions.
Exactly. Very, very common, isn't it? That's the commonest thing. You always see water particles on that thing, and that gets blocked, and it stops working. Right, okay, then.
And high altitude can affect the capnography, ma'am. If there is reduction of atmospheric pressure, the chance of EKCO2 calibration is altered.
Okay. Okay, what are the abnormal waveforms?
Ma'am, the abnormal waveforms, a normal waveform is a inverted sine hat form. And I will talk about the abnormal waveforms, ma'am. The normal EDCD value is 35 to 45 mmHg. If the height of the waveform is decreased, then...
Did you tell me about the four phases of capnogram? You said the angles, alpha angle and beta angle. Did you tell me about the four phases?
Mentioned, ma'am. There are two segments, infinity segment and expirative segment. In infinity segment, it has phase zero, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. Continue.
And in the expirative segment, it has three phases. Phase one, phase two, and phase three, ma'am.
Okay. Fine. Very good.
Ma'am, can I explain it again, ma'am?
Not necessary.
Okay, ma'am.
Unless you want to say.
The phase one is initial stage of escalation, in which the gas is sampled from the anatomical dead space and the apparatus dead space. It is free of ETCO2, free of CO2, ma'am. And phase two is the expiratory upstroke. It is the combination of dead space and the alveolar gas. There is rapid rise. And the phase three is the alveolar plateau phase. It is the exact alveolar gas, ma'am.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you. Ma'am, shall I continue with the gas, ma'am?
Start of inspiration again.
All right.
Very good. Okay.
Ma'am, the graphs, can I explain them? Because I don't
know. Yes, please. A few of them. At least a few of them. They are the common ones.
Okay. Ma'am, the normal ETCO2 value is 35 to 45 mm. Hello, ma'am?
Yeah, continue.
35 to 45 mm. So if there is a low ETCO2 due to hyperventilation, there will be a decrease in the height of the waveforms, ma'am. And if there is hypoventilation, there will be increase in the height of the waveforms, ma'am. And third waveform, abnormal waveform, is the curare cleft, ma'am. During spontaneous ventilation seen in between the relaxant.
Okay, and the patient is coming out of the effect of the relaxant.
And
you can get
relaxant.
Yes.
Can get right left.
Yes.
And after the mechanical ventilation, ma'am, the fourth abnormal waveform is the spontaneous respiratory effects after the mechanical ventilation, like weaning off, there will be small notch, ma'am, after the waveform.
Okay. If this spontaneous breath after that's okay. Yes. Okay.
And fifth is the cardiogenic oscillations. Cardiogenic oscillations, which can be seen in the pediatric and very lean patients. There will be fibrillations like in the plateau phase.
Okay. What will happen in COPD, in obstruction, airway obstruction? Bronchospasm.
And there will be increase in the alpha angle, ma'am.
What is it called?
Sharp in appearance.
Okay.
In the ETCO2, that is the fifth abnormality, ma'am. Okay. And if there is rebreathing, the baseline is elevated, ma'am.
Okay.
And the return to the spontaneous ventilation after CPR, there will be small waveforms followed by rapid upstroke. In the waveform indicates the ROSA, ma'am.
Okay, very good.
Other than that, there are inspiratory valve incompetence and expiratory valve incompetence failed form.
Correct.
And hello.
So for this, for all this, when you're talking about capnogram, it would have been better if you'd had a PPT for just the waveforms alone. Without that, when you talk, it's not possible for people to understand, isn't it? When you talk about faces, about the angle, about the different kinds of waveforms, without looking at it, yes. It doesn't make an impact. It's okay. We are only discussing a theory paper, but things like this, it is better you have a presentation just for this alone. You don't have to present the whole thing. Okay. All right.
Okay,
Pavitra.
Thank you, ma'am. In addition to why are you not talking about
causes of increase in ETCO2? What
causes
are the causes of increase in? What are the causes of increase in ETCO2?
Hypoventilation, ma'am.
Increase. Hypoventilation, okay. See, they can be because of giving an extraneous carbon dioxide, like in case of a laparoscopic surgery. Okay, like in case of laparoscopic surgery. Or it can be to increase production of carbon dioxide in the body, like malignant hyperpyrexia, fever, sepsis, shivering, Cushing's, like endocrine disease. These are the things where there is excess production in the body. Okay, you're either giving it from outside, like a laparoscopic surgery, or there is increased production in the carbon dioxide, or the carbon dioxide is not getting ventilated out, like a hypoventilation. So these are the causes. If you think of these causes, you won't miss out anything. So these are the causes of high ETCO2. In a similar circumstance, what are the causes of low ETCO2? Pulmonary embolism, first thing you must think. See, Pavitra, this is what I say. You all are not applying whatever you all are reading. Yeah? You have to apply. Whenever you read something, it's not enough if you just write in the theory and pass your exam. You have to apply and understand what you are writing and reading. Okay, so the causes of low ETCO2, where can it be low? Which means you are hyperventilation, you're washing away all the carbon dioxide. It can be hyperventilation, right? Or it can be a place where there is no exchange. Nothing is happening, like a case of pulmonary embolism. Where else it cannot exchange? When there's a low cardiac output. It's not reached. Or when there is slowing of circulation, anemia. Like in a hypothermia. Anemia, I can't say that. Yeah, you can say that. Low cardiac output. Anemia is not low cardiac output. Hypothermia. In hypothermia, you will have a low ETCO2. Okay, so these are the conditions. So you have to apply your mind when you read. That's all. Okay. There's no point. So what you do now is, after having read this and whatever you have written now, I'll go through that again. I think Kamakshi sent it to me. I didn't read it. So I will read it again. And then I will give you more comments on this. So when you talk about capnography as a clinical thing, you first say, what is capnography, principle of capnography, types of capnography, advantages and disadvantages, what are the waveforms, common waveforms, you talk about each of the phases, and then you say about the, what else did I say? I said something else. Technical, all the technical considerations, how to read a capnography, abnormal wave, regular waveform, abnormal waveform. What are the conditions where ETCO2 is high? What are the conditions where ETCO2 is low? And the use of capnogram, especially in CPR, that you must mention. We say the uses of capnography and how for, and of course, you said about the fallacies, about the disadvantages, which you can have sometimes, but you never do a case without. ETCO2 monitor, whether it is in general anesthesia, when you give general anesthesia. That much, if you understand, it's good. Okay? All right. Good, Pavitra. You read well, but you're not applying well enough. Okay? So you apply better next time. All right? Good job. All right. Okay. We are done or we have one more?
We have one more, Madam. Dr. Thania from Balaji Medical College.
Okay, sure.
Postoperative pulmonary complications.
Pulmonary complications in a non-cardiac surgery.
Yes, ma'am.
That's the topic, no?
Yes, madam.
Okay, I read this. I read this question. It's better she they present it. But what, you present first, then I'll talk.
Dr. Thania?
presenter is missing.
No, you have to unmute yourself. Hello. Yeah, I can hear you on phone. Your iPhone. Which name it is there? No, we are not able to hear you. Hello, madam, our audio visuals are not getting connected.
No, participants audio, I can't hear at all. I can only hear you.
Yeah, she is able to hear herself, but her mic is not on.
Oh.
Yeah. So, can you just briefly say some important points about this, madam, and I'll ask her to present on Friday?
Sure, I will. Okay. So main thing when you talk about postoperative the topic today is postoperative pulmonary complications following non-cardiac surgery. So what I would like you all to remember is it's one of the commonest complications that happen, and main thing is and what definitions you would take is the respiratory complications that occur within 48 to 72 hours following surgery, and it can be anywhere in the respiratory tract. Can be from the bronchus or the alveoli or the or the cavity or whatever. It can be anywhere in the respiratory tract, and any pulmonary abnormality occurring in the postoperative period, okay, where there is a dysfunction there's a dysfunction in the breathing of the patient. There's a wide spectrum. There's a wide spectrum of pulmonary complications, and it can be. Starting from respiratory failure, very common thing is atelectasis. Atelectasis, which happens in the postoperative period, especially upper abdominal surgery, massive upper abdominal surgery in a patient who is obese, in a patient who's got a preoperative lung dysfunction. These are patients who are more prone for atelectasis, and these are the one which commonly they go on for postoperative. Hypoxia, and then of course pneumonia, bronchitis is something, and bronchospasm, laryngospasm that you always see in the on the table itself. You can see it's not usually not exactly postoperative. It can happen on the table also, and if the patient has a prior lung disease, that can get exaggerated. Okay, so that is the main reason. Again, here this pulmonary complication is divided. It has certain gradings. Post-operative pulmonary complications has four grades, and the first grade is anything which is abnormal from the normal course. The patient does not have has some amount of hypoxia, and it requires some kind of an intervention. That is grade one. Grade two is. They require specific pharmacological treatment. Like, for example, if the patient develops pneumonia, he requires antibiotics. If the patient develops bronchospasm, they need bronchodilators, things like that. Grade three is becoming worse, obviously, isn't it? When the patient develops a pneumothorax or a pleural effusion or something else, it becomes worse. So that is grade three. And grade four is life-threatening complication where the patient needs to go to the ICU. This can happen in patients who are having prolonged surgery, or in patients, mainly these cases have lung problems because we don't prepare the patient properly in the preoperative period. If you don't prepare the patient properly in the preoperative period, take up the patient with an existing lung disease like the patient has a acute infection, or patient has a bronchiectasis with the infection, or patient has had a just recovered from pneumonia, and the patient's lung function has not gone back to normal. These are patients where the patient can go for a life-threatening complications. So the important aspect of preventing a post-operative lung complication is preparing a patient properly. Okay, so this is something which requires meticulous attention in the pre-operative period itself. And that the peculiarity about this, that's what they always say, is it is preventable. This post-operative pulmonary complication is preventable if you are careful about preparing the patient and taking the right steps to prevent this complication. Okay, so that's the main thing. So why are we concerned about post-operative lung complication? Basically, because we don't want any hypoxia. The main thing is post-operative hypoxia. Again, atelectasis. Like I said, the commonest problem is atelectasis. And atelectasis is divided into certain groups. It is called absorption atelectasis and compressive atelectasis. I didn't take down notes for that because it's quite some time since I read about it. And this happens because when they do prolonged surgery, like laparoscopic surgery, in steep and down tilts. Okay, when they do that, never be in a hurry to extubate the patient, especially if the patient is obese. So these patients require a good ventilation and PEEP. You have to give them good PEEP and make sure that you recruit enough alveoli to prevent this post-operative complication. Very, very important. Okay, recruitment maneuvers is very important. And before extubation also, you have to do this recruitment maneuver. And another important aspect is hyperoxygenation. Again, we always say, keep on giving oxygen. We have to nitrous oxide will be there. We have to get the nitrous oxide out. Let's give more oxygen. When you keep doing that, too much oxygen is also bad for the patient. Okay, so that can also produce atelectasis. Though we have wanted giving it to prevent diffusion hypoxia, you must not overdo it. That's one thing. And of course, even the patient is obese, you must make sure that you give CPAP during intubation, during pre-oxygenation as well as at extubation. This is a very important aspect. And methods to prevent this post-operative hypoxia is, of course, pain relief. Excellent pain relief you must give. And like I said earlier, pre-operative preparation is so, so important. Spirometry, incentive spirometry, bronchodilators, preparation is so important. Same thing in the post-operative period. And post-operative pneumonia is another important thing. What are the factors? Again, when you talk about any complication, you first say, let me put my video. Yeah. When you talk about the complications, you first say, what is the complication? What happens because of the complications? So suppose you take pneumonia, right? The patient could have had a pneumonia in the preoperative period, and that might not have been treated properly. Like COVID pneumonia, for example, if you take it now, we come across patients with COVID pneumonia, isn't it? So they're not completely recovered, and we are pushed to a stage where we have to take up these patients under general anesthesia. We need to be careful because this can exacerbate in the post-operative period, and the patient can develop pneumonia in the post-operative period. Again, the type of tube that we use for endotracheal intubation, you must make sure that it's absolutely sterile, and you must use all the aseptic precautions when you're using an endotracheal tube. That is extremely important. And the circuits and everything else must be completely sterile. You must use only disposable ones for these patients. We should never reuse. That's another important aspect of it. And if the patient has a NG tube, nasogastric tube, or the patient has chances of GERD or aspiration, you've got to make sure that the stomach is alkalized, the stomach secretions are alkalized properly. You have to give the ranitidine or pantocid or whatever, and make sure that there is no aspiration. You have to prevent aspiration. Another important complication that happens in the immediate post-operative period is micro aspiration of the gastric contents, which we don't see at all in a normal patient. In a normal patient whose lungs are good, they will not precipitate into major issues. But if the patient has some kind of an underlying lung pathology, even this small amount of micro aspiration can precipitate pneumonia in the postoperative period. Okay. If I put the video on, I think there's some disturbance. Anything else you want to know? Basically, it is atelectasis, pneumonia, and you have to take all the methods to prevent aspiration. Another important thing is following blood transfusion. You can have TRALI, isn't it? Transfusion related acute lung injury. That's something you have to talk about. ARDS, another is ARDS, and of course, nothing is complete without acid aspiration syndrome or the Mendelsohn syndrome when you talk about postoperative pulmonary complication. You have to talk about TRALI, you have to talk about ARDS, you have to talk about Mendelsohn syndrome, and then of course pulmonary edema, negative pressure pulmonary edema. These are also, again, some of the complications that you can come across. So embolism, another important thing is embolism. So these are the common complications that can following any surgery. Need not be cardiac, and it can following non-cardiac surgery also. These are the common postoperative complications. Okay. And if it's an acute lung injury, it can prove fatal. So if you have written your question based on this, then the answer will be complete. So whoever is going to talk, if she is ready, she can come back and talk to me on that.
Madam, should we add the preoperative steps to decrease the incidence of postoperative complications like smoking?
Yes.
Self-smoking, physiotherapy.
Yes, you should. I said preoperative preparation is very, very important. Preoperative preparation to prevent postoperative pulmonary complication is an extremely important aspect of it. Definitely, you have to make a mention on smoking. But you don't have to elaborate and say, basic thing is, the problems of smoking, how the ciliary activity is reduced, carbon monoxide levels are increased, and the patient has a more chances of developing postoperative pulmonary complications. So you have to, in a nutshell, if you want to talk, you have to say about the preoperative lung preparation, intraoperative precautions that you will take to prevent complications. What are the common postoperative problems? How to identify it, how to treat it. If you write that on those lines, everything will be complete. So basically it is atelectasis, pneumonia, acute lung injury, TRALI, then aspiration pneumonitis, like you have pulmonary edema, or you can have a Mendelsohn syndrome, or you can have, of course, negative pressure pulmonary edema. These are some of the respiratory complications that can come in a non-cardiac patient. So based on this, you can talk. Pulmonary edema, of course, more in cardiac also, but it can also happen in non-cardiac surgeries. All depends on how we ventilate the patient, how we oxygenate the patient and all that. And of course, depends upon the preoperative condition and the type of surgery that the patient is coming for. So if you write it on this lines, even if you don't write about the details about each of them, you will cover most of it. Is she ready? Is that girl ready? Is that person ready?
No, madam, our mic is still not working. So I'll ask her to present next time, madam.
No, this is okay. This is what I said is more than enough for them to write an answer.
She has a message right now. She is ready, but she's trying to connect, but it's not getting connected.
Oh, it's not connecting. Okay, no, it doesn't matter at all. No problem. I think we have covered, I think I have done her job. And I've said most of what has to be said.
I'll try to test her audio visuals and get her connected on Friday, Priya, madam.
Friday. Yeah, sir will be doing. Friday, I think Dr. Bagsam will be doing. I think maybe at that time we can put it. He will make some He makes, he likes to do PPTs. I don't like PPTs. So I hope the students are able to understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, that's what we have to ask feedback from the students, madam. Comments or feedback from the students?
Yeah, you can be bold. You can tell me what you want. And if you have not understood what I'm talking or whatever, if I'm a little fast or whatever, let me know so that I can make you all understand better. That's all. You can talk anything you want. If you like the class, say you like the class. If you say you don't like the class, say you don't like it. No issues at all.
Can I request Dr. Sushil Krishnan, who is our faculty from Northern Illinois Central Hospital?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, yes.
So, Sushil? Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, you are. Yes, Sushil, you are on.
Yes. Good evening, ma'am. At the beginning, I was just trying to make one point regarding those specific questions. There are quite a few popping up in DNB these days, which are almost, you could say, cutting edge kind of things. And that I thought that question was an example of that, the one about Dakey's arthroplasty. Because it is such a cutting edge thing. Unfortunately, I think students cannot confine themselves there only to the textbook. Because for example, even in the textbook, they would cover only say something up to say an adductor canal block. And truly speaking, the daycare ones which are being done say for total knee right now, they're moving beyond just adductor along with things like a capsular, posterior capsular block or genicular blocks, and this is the way it's actually being done. And also that one change also, which most daycare was formerly done by using GA, but here again with the chlorprocaine and spinal anesthesia seems to be the way to go. So the general point I'm making is that there are a few questions which are popping up, which the students will not be able to answer purely by the textbook, and they will have to read the recent advances and so on, that sort of thing.
No, they can. What I'm saying is what they have the tendency now, Dr. Sushil, is not reading the book at all. That is not a good thing. Yeah. So you read the text, you get the gist of it, you understand the subject, and then read anything. You definitely have to read the recent advances, the journals, the articles, everything, but not without reading the text. That's what I was trying to say.
That's the basics. Yeah, yeah. And once again, thank you, ma'am. It's a pleasure, and we are all your students. So it's an absolute pleasure to listen to this, and we gain every day when we attend these classes. So again, and thanks a lot to Kamachi once again. I've said it.
Yeah, not at all. No, even I learn every time he gives me a topic. I sit and read, and I learn something new. So I'm quite happy
thank
to
listen. So
yeah, thank you. All right.
Any comments and requests from the students, Dr. Pratik Shukla or Dr. Pavitra? We want to hear from you.
Thank you, ma'am. This class is really very helpful for us, ma'am. We are just knowledge from means really, ma'am. It's really helpful how to write the answers, ma'am. I'm gaining the confidence how to write the answers and how to gain proper number of marks by writing correct answer now. Thank you, ma'am.
Sure. Okay. All right.
Ma'am, thank you. Thank you so much. Personally, okay. I am the one who is very glad and blessed to have you as my teacher for three decades.
Not at all.
And it's a really great and extraordinary, so eminent support you are providing for us all through these years, and specifically for our railway students who are spread across the country. And we are in a different position. Not like we can't be compared with medical colleges nor with corporate hospitals. We are in between, like Trisangu Swargam. So it's really kind enough from your side to provide us with this great support. And on behalf of all our railway faculty and our students, I thank you once again, madam. And we'll continue to hear more from you, take your advice, and provide best of our care and services to our patients. I still remember, whatever we read, whatever we speak, whatever we think, whatever we do, whatever we earn, everything is second. Only the first and prime important thing is patient care and patient welfare, patient safety. That's what the thing we have learned all these years from our teachers and especially you, madam. I always remember that whether we intubate or not, whether we are able to prove ourselves as better as anesthetist or not in front of the staff or surgeons, that is immaterial. We have to be safe and successful anesthesia doctors, physicians for the patients. So ventilating and oxygenating the patient is more important than just doing a good laryngoscopy or doing all the techniques and intubating. So the core primary purpose of our profession is to do good to the patient. Primum non nocere is our basic rule. So let us not I will not go in the negative like forensic. Let us be very safe and productive for our patients and for our faculty. And great thanks from the depth of my heart on behalf of all our RISA members and our students for our professors. Thank you, madam. With your permission, shall we wind up this?
Yeah, not at all. It's my pleasure to do the classes for you all. And if you want something else, if the students want something else, please let me know, because I like to discuss offhand like this, because that I read. Every time you send me the topic, I read it. So that way I can do it. And I'm sure they can pick up quite a bit. But if they want something else more, ask them to feel free to talk and say what they want. Okay?
Yes.
So we can do better. Right? All the best. All the best. All of you did well. Only the first one was not sufficient. It's just that he didn't read enough, because it doesn't have like Dr.
Dr. Arun and Dr. Pavitra, they all have.
No. The first speaker. The first speaker.
Muthumani is a first year student, and.
He didn't get a proper text for reading about it. But definitely, what he could have done is he could have spoken about daycare surgery. He could have spoken about the innovation of the knee joint, and then he could have said what drugs to use, how to give analgesia for that, and what are the problems, things like that. If he does that, then you would have done much better.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Every time we will definitely guide you, and you will do, and all of you will be toppers in all over whatever you do. Okay. Yes. All the best.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'll see you on Friday. I think Nagasami sir will do something on Friday, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'll join you. I'll join you at that time, but I will do your class next Tuesday.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
All right. Bye bye.
Sign off this meeting, madam. Thank you.
Good night.
Good night, ma'am. Thank you, students. Bye.